let's rewind that. There goes a passing car. And let's watch it all over again. In this video, I'm going to share with you the proven and defined process that you can implement if you see your mate or somebody go down while road cycling. Now, I'm aware that the title and the footage in this video is extreme, but I didn't make that footage up. These things actually do happen on our roads. And that man that you saw go down tumbling across the side of the road, he was very fortunate. There was no oncoming traffic. He picked his bike up, got up, he had a few scratches on himself and the bike, but was able to ride off. And I hate to say it, but if that actually happened 6.8 seconds prior, that could have been fatal for that man, or he could have been left on the side of the road in a very critical condition. Now, the facts are here in Australia, based on an Australian Institute of Health and Welfare report that was released in May this year, found that 12,000 cyclists were admitted to hospital in the year to June 2016. And that hospitalisation number that I just shared with you is actually up 60% from the year 2000, which does make a bit of sense when I think about the population boom that we've had in a number of our major cities here in Australia. A lot of people driving cars, a lot of people road cycling. The probability of something unfortunate happening has been heightened. Now, there will be a lot of people out there that are familiar with the first aid process, but I truly believe there will be even more people out there that are either hazy or don't have a true understanding of what to do if somebody goes down next to you. And the reason why I believe that is, even myself, I'll put my hand up. I recently updated my first aid as part of becoming a cycling coach, and I hadn't done my first aid for perhaps 12 years. So if somebody had gone down next to me, say 2-3 months ago, I would have been a little bit hazy on what to do. And if that's you, I really challenge you to watch this video to the very end. So I'm about to introduce you to a lady called Vicky Kelly and her dog, who was my first aid teacher. And Vicky has been in emergency services for over 15 years, both in the field of instructing basic life support to all the advanced and pre-hospital care courses. She's a qualified medic and passionate about teaching life-saving skills. The scenario that I paint for Vicky is that I'm out riding on the road in a bunch. I'm next to my good mate, John. John hits something on the road. He goes over his handlebars. He's on the ground. It doesn't look good. What should I do? Now, before we get into the video with Vicky, just be aware there's something at the end of the first aid process, which is called defibrillation. We don't go into that topic in detail in this video because the fact is, if you're out road cycling, the likelihood of having access to one of those machines is minimal. However, if you want more information on that topic, I'll link to it below. And let's get into the video.
Okay.
What do I do?
All right, so there's an acronym that we use for first aid and emergency response,
yep.
And it's DRSABCD.
Okay.
So your first priority is to check for dangers first,
okay.
So check all your surrounds.
Right,
so but
he's on the road.
Am yeah.
Am I dragging him off the road?
No, you're not dragging him off the road at the moment. We're going to get the other cyclists to secure the area.
Oh, okay.
So that you can do an assessment on John and at least sustain his airway if needed.
Right.
So check for dangers. The other cyclists have secured all the area for you.
Mm-hmm.
And then we're going to check for response on John. So here's John. So we're just going to have a visual look and make sure there's no major bleeds.
Mm.
And it'll give you just a general appearance of what he looks like as well.
Right.
So your next step is response. So we do a verbal response first. So we call out to John. John, can you hear me? Open your eyes. What's your name?
Mm.
And then we can ask John to squeeze my hands to see if we can get any response. And you can also do another pain stimulus as well.
Okay.
So we go in there.
So what does that look like?
We just go in above the collarbones and we squeeze both shoulders to see if we can get some sort of pain stimuli going on the patient.
Okay, right.
Yeah.
And what's that going to tell you?
If there's no response to pain, it could mean that he's profoundly unconscious, so he will lose his airway fairly quickly.
Right.
Yeah. So John's kind of given me a bit of a groan and made a few noises. So we still need to check airways and breathing first, but before we do that, we send for help.
Okay.
So we've got 000 that we phone, and we also have 112 on a mobile.
Right, if and there's necessary. An app you mentioned as well, which there's we can link to below.
Yeah. So Emergency Plus app, that's a very good app. It's a free download for everyone to access.
Okay. Cool.
Yeah, so that will give you your exactly where you are if you're not sure where you are.
Okay.
All right, so to check an airway, we're going to support John's head. We're going to grab his chin and just pull his chin down and just check there's nothing in that airway.
Okay.
Once we've done that, we've checked it's clear.
Yep.
Take your hand off the chin, and then we're going to bring John's head back. And we're going to check for breathing. So we can feel for breath on our cheek, hand on the belly, then we're going to check for movement.
Right.
John, so if John has indicated that he's breathing adequately, we're going to place John in recovery position.
Right.
So we put a hand underneath John's shoulder, his leg is bent up, and we go from the knee. We get John on the left-hand side. Left-hand side is optimal for all patients.
Okay, why is that?
Because there's a big vein on the right-hand side of the body that supplies our heart with blood.
Right. What do you reckon about this down there? Do you want to be John? No? Okay, we'll stick with this John. All right.
All right, so once we have John in recovery position, we can bring his head back and drop his mouth towards the ground.
Mm-hmm.
We can have our hand in front of his mouth to check. We can also feel for breathing on the back of our hand, on the back of our arm. And the other hand goes on the belly, and you're, you know, checking that he's breathing adequately.
Yep.
So he has indicated that he's breathing okay.
Okay.
So we can just keep John in that position and just monitor.
Until the professionals arrive.
Until the professionals arrive, that's right.
So what if he's not breathing properly?
Okay, so if we do our assessment, we find that John isn't breathing adequately.
How would we know he's not breathing adequately?
You'll see changes of colour around his lips.
Right.
So the colour starts to go away, and it's called cyanosis.
Right.
So you can also, so you still do your dangers, check for response. So you do your verbal, you do your pain stimulus.
Yes.
He hasn't responded, so you still need to check airways and breathing.
Yes.
So we grab his chin, check his airway,
yep.
Make sure there's nothing in there, bring the head back, and now we're going to check for breathing. Mm. And what you may hear if he's not breathing adequately is a few strange noises.
Right, okay.
Yeah, so that means that they're not breathing adequately.
Yeah, right.
So it's not consistent, it's called chain strokes.
Yes.
And sometimes there's another one called stridor, so they make all these strange noises,
yes.
But it's not breathing adequately.
Right.
So in that scenario, we need to do CPR.
Right.
So if you can grab one of the cyclists, it'd be good if one can do compressions and the other one do breath.
Yes, okay.
Breath is a choice, but if you don't have the right personal protective equipment, which is a resus mask there.
So you could carry this on the bike, probably.
Yeah, you most
back
certainly
pocket,
could.
Couldn't you?
Yes.
Be smart.
Yeah, it would be good.
But you were saying if you don't have that and you don't necessarily know that person, you would recommend just to stick with...
Just to stick with CPR.
Just a CPR.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So, why is that?
Because when you're doing CPR on a patient, you're actually building up, it's called a recoil, negative pressure in the chest cavity.
Right.
So we're getting the blood supply from the brain to the heart stem, the heart to the brain stem.
Yes.
And we want to keep that going on the patient. That's the most important thing.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah. If you take your hands off the chest and you're trying to fumble around and, you know, do an airway, you're wasting pressure for this person.
Yeah.
And we want to keep that systemic blood flow going as well.
Okay. Yeah.
Cool. So for your compressions, feel on the base of the ribs on the patient. There's a little bone at the base there. We want to stay off that. So, you know, for an adult, it's roughly about 3 finger spaces up off that.
Yeah.
And we have our hands right there. You can have your hands at whatever's comfortable for you.
Yep.
Just make sure that you keep your arms nice and straight, otherwise you'll use your whole body and you'll get fatigued very quickly.
Okay.
Yeah, so 30 compressions.
Can you show us what a compression looks like?
Sure. So it's just... It's a bit hard on the top.
Okay.
It's a bit slow on there, but so nice and rhythmic, nice and deep.
Yep.
And
if you've got one of these?
If you have one of those.
So after 30 of those, two of these, what does that look like?
So we're going to have two of you working together.
Yes.
We would have the resus mask. This part goes over the patient's nose or John's nose.
Yep.
Fingers there and your middle fingers underneath that jawline, and we're going to bring that head back.
Yes.
And that way we can see whether we're getting breath into the chest and make sure that we're not getting into the belly.
Right.
So if you do see the belly distending, that means that you haven't got the airway open enough.
Right, okay.
Yeah. So two quick sharp breaths. You don't have to put a lot of breath into the patient.
Yep.
Breath is a choice, but certainly if there's two of you and you do have the right equipment, that would be optimal for the patient.
What does the breath look like? Can you show us?
Yeah, certainly.
Short little breaths there.
Short little breaths,
okay. So if you're doing this, 32, 32, and John comes too, what does that typically look like? How do you know?
Sometimes they have to open their eyes and take a spontaneous breath.
Right.
But you still need to check that they're breathing adequately.
Right,
yeah.
Okay.
So,
And then would you roll them over to the side?
Yeah, you can put them into recovery position
yeah.
if they have responded. Right. You know, the optimal time to get on that chest is as quick as you can.
Yeah.
Okay. And that way there could be a possibility of a good response.
Yeah, okay.
Hopefully.
Right.
Yeah. So if there is just one of you, chest only, if there's someone else around but you don't have a resus mask, you could actually get the other person just to sit in that position and sustain that airway for right. John. Yeah.
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 Why would you recommend not going mouth to mouth?
Well, if you don't have the right equipment and you don't know the person or they're not family, you don't actually know what other people have. So, you need to keep yourself safe. Yeah. You're the priority first.
Yeah.
Keep yourself safe and then you can help somebody if you need to.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, that's definitely.
Cool. Mm. All right. Thanks for sharing. Really
that's all right,
stuff.
John. Yeah, most definitely. Life, you know, it's a life saving skill.
Absolutely.
I think everyone needs to learn it.
All right.
Okay. Thanks, Cameron.